morning. Kind of out of breath, running around this morning. Welcome to Atlanta First United Methodist Church. So glad to have you here today. Those of you who are in the sanctuary and those of you who are watching online. I want you to make sure that you download your worship guide. There's a lot of information in there about what's going on in the life of the church and announcements that I will be sharing a few of them with you right now. First of all, our longtime ministry partners, Midtown Assistance Center, has put together an Amazon list, Amazon wish list. So if you want to donate to Midtown Assistance Center, you could go on Amazon, look for their wish list, and send things to them directly from Amazon. Or if you want to bring it yourself, you can bring it to their address that is listed in the worship guide on Spring Street, or you can have things sent, you can bring them to the church and we'll make sure that they get them. As we are continuing our season of growing with God, I hope you all are still reading your chapters every week as we go through the Bible this year. We are still in Psalms, and so I hope you're all still doing that. Let's not forget our Tuesday night prayer, a growing strong church prays together. And I know you can set aside about 15 minutes at 6:30 on Tuesday evening just to have prayer with us. The information on how to come in on the Zoom with the meeting ID and the passcode is listed in the worship guide. Also, I don't want you to forget this fall, our small group classes will be gearing up. You could go on our church website and hit the Grow link, and there will be a link there for you to register for all our small group classes that's coming up in the fall. That's our Thursday morning class and our Tuesday evening class. Okay, and lastly, I just wanted to remind you, if you're considering going on the trip to the Holy Lands with Pastor Jasmine next year, next month, June, is one of the deadlines where you can do $100 for to get registered, and then that $100 comes back off the price of the cruise. So if you're thinking about going with her on the cruise, please don't forget about trying to get registered in June, because you get a little bit more money back if you do it. I think that's about everything that I have today. So let us get our hearts and minds as we get ready to worship God in this series, The Aftermath, that Pastor Jasmine is doing. So let us stand for our affirmation of faith that is printed in the worship guide and on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us remain standing for our hymn of praise that is printed in the worship guide on page 6 and will be on the screen. Lead me, guide me.
Guide me, Yes, amen, amen, amen. Lead us, O Lord. Lead us, O Lord. Lead us, O Lord. Lead us. You may be seated. I'm Jasmine Smothers, and I'm the lead pastor here at Atlanta First United Methodist Church in downtown Atlanta, Georgia. And it is my joy and honor to welcome you to worship today here in the sanctuary and online. We are thrilled that you have chosen to worship with this community of faith. Whether you are here physically or virtually, you are honored for your presence and your worship of God this morning. At Atlanta First, we exist to worship God, to serve people, to grow together, and to engage the city of Atlanta and beyond. And there are many opportunities for you to do that if you'll download your worship guide and go through it this week. I want to remind you of the summer wish list that our partner Midtown Assistance Center has. You can get it off of Amazon, or you can call the church office and we will provide the list for you. You can either take your donations directly there, have them shipped there, or bring them here to the church and we will deliver them. It's been an incredible spring for the need, and I know that the summer will continue to show us incredible need. So let us pour out our generosity on each and every one of our neighbors during this summer season. Also, go ahead and plan for Friends at the Front Door on Tuesday, June 6th, as we serve our community together. Well, friends, it's Ascension Sunday, and that means we celebrate that Jesus has indeed completed his task here on earth and is now with the Father. Amen? That's good news for us today. Good news for us today. So it means that when we go to God in prayer, that our prayers are indeed heard and acted upon. So I invite you to the prayer, to the altar rail this morning, to be in prayer one for another. And also invite you to lift up the folks who are on the prayer list for this week. You'll see that also I wanted to let you know that longtime member of Atlanta First, Lucille Mitchell, passed away this week. I will never forget Lucille Mitchell. Right when it was announced that I was to come here as your associate pastor in 2008, Lucille came to the church where I was serving at the time, which was the Powder Springs First United Methodist Church, and we were getting ready to process into the sanctuary, Mary. And she walked up to me and she said, "I am Lucille Mitchell. I am here on behalf of Atlanta, of First United Methodist Church of Atlanta, and I have come to check you out today." And so I will never forget her and her ministry among us and among the Powder Springs community in these last few years. If you have prayer concerns, please place your prayer cards in the offering plates a little later today or email them to us at prayer@atlantafirstumc.org. Let us go to God in prayer. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear our humble cries, O Lord. Yes, yes, yes. And while on others thou art calling, do not, Lord, pass us by. Heavenly Father, we have come expecting to be in your presence, oh God. We have come today knowing that we know that we know that you are the great I am. We have come to praise the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. We have come to praise you, Creator God, for it is you that spun this creation into life, O God. You were with Moses and Abraham and all the prophets, O God, and you have been with our Messiah, Jesus Christ, and you are with us even now, O God. So for this, we praise your holy name. We lift you up, O God. We magnify your holy name, for if we had 10,000 tongues, we could not praise you enough, O God. We can't praise you enough for waking us up this morning and starting us on our way. We cannot praise you enough, O God, for the opportunities to serve you and to serve your people in this life, O God. We can't praise you enough for continuing to blow the breath of life into us and for giving us another opportunity to be your hands and your feet in this city and beyond. Oh Lord, we praise you, for you have kept your promises. We praise you, oh God, for you have never left us nor forsaken us. We praise you because you have been the light of the world and the light in the darkness, oh God. We praise you because you said you would send us a Savior, O God, and that Savior has ascended unto you. And Lord, now we wait for the power of your Holy Spirit to fall fresh on us. So Holy Ghost, have your way. Have your way in this place. Have your way in these people, O God. Have your way, Lord Jesus. Have your way so that we might experience your power, O God. Have your way so that our faith is not merely a word or not merely something that we talk about, but what we live, O God. Have your way as we praise you. And have your way, O God, in the healing of those who are on our prayer list. We lift up today our lay leader, Wayne Pierce. We lift up the loved ones of Lucille Mitchell. We lift up our neighbors and our friends in this city and beyond. We lift up our bishop, O God, and we lift up our district superintendents and the extended cabinet. We lift up those who continue to partner with us on affordable housing, Lord. And we lift up those who are still counting the number of mass shootings in this country as we continue to be affected by gun violence, O Lord. Show us your way through, O God. Show us your way out. Show us your way to abundant life, Holy God. Now, Lord, we ask for a fresh anointing in this place. We ask that you would renew us and restore us, that you would forgive us and receive our repentance, O God. We ask that you would continue to love us as only you can, so that we might be your example of love with all that we come in contact with. And Lord, remind us when things are hard that you've been there, that you have had us in mind the entire time, and that if we'll just lean on you, O God, you will indeed make a way. So, Lord, we thank you for teaching us the prayer that you taught your disciples, and that we are now so bold to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. 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 Do not pass us by, O God. Do not pass us by. O Lord, we're grateful today to bring into your storehouse the tithes and the offerings that we give back to you as generously as you have given them unto us, O God. We pray that you would allow us to continue to be your hands and feet in this city and beyond. And I invite each of you to pour out generously, especially this summer, as these are usually our lower giving months, but our higher need months. So as you travel, as you are in different places, continue to keep your church in mind and your commitment to those whom we serve. So we invite the ushers to come at this time as we invite our worship team. I'm so glad that everybody's back today. And we welcome Ms. Ronnie Jackson to our church. We're so glad to have you among us as they lead us, continue to lead us in worship through song. Thank you. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Please stand as we lift up our praise to the Lord. I want to invite our children to lean in for just a minute, our big children and our little children. Today, we continue our sermon series, The Aftermath, and we actually end it today where we started it. You'll remember a few weeks ago, we talked about the road to Emmaus, and the scripture that we're going to talk about today is what happens after the walk on Emmaus when Jesus reveals himself to those two friends, and they run back and tell the disciples that everything God promised is happening, and it's coming true. Well, the beginning of the text that we're not actually going to read in worship today, but I invite you to read with your parents or read at home starting in the 30th verse of Luke chapter 24. Jesus appears to the disciples who are scared. They are afraid of what is going to happen to them now that Jesus has died. And they're not quite sure yet what to do with this whole resurrection from the dead thing and that Jesus is alive. They're just scared. Have you ever been scared? Have you ever been afraid? Have you ever wondered, oh my goodness, what am I gonna do? Well, that's one of those situations. And do you know what Jesus says to them? He appears to them in what we call the upper room. It was a gathering place, and those who are going to travel to the Holy Land, we're going to visit the upper room. But do you know what Jesus said to the scared disciples? He said, peace. 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 Peace be unto you. So when you are afraid, which is natural and normal, adults get afraid. Did you know that? We try to cover it up, but we get afraid. And sometimes we're not very nice when we're afraid because we don't want other people to know that we're afraid. But instead, we can just lean into it a little bit. We can feel what we feel and be where we are, and we can take a page out of the book of Jesus, who says to our fear, who says to our doubts, peace. Do you know what peace means? It means don't worry. Peace means I've got this. Peace means just be still and take a deep breath and let Jesus do what Jesus does. So when things are crazy, when they're out of control, these last few days of school or at home this summer or even at church, just say peace in the name of Jesus and let it go. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you give us guides for what to do when things may not be going our way. We thank you, oh God, that you give us instructions, that you are our GPS, that you tell us what to do and where to go if we'll just listen to you. So, Lord, help us experience your peace, the peace that passes all understanding, the peace that says that everything is under control when all we feel is chaos. Help us to feel your peace and to be your peace, oh God, when we are afraid. We love you, Jesus, and we thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let him have his way.
know the power of letting go and letting God? How many of you know that we don't have to be in charge all the time? How many of you know that God is at work in each and every one of our lives? If we'll just get out of God's way.
Yes.
And let go. And let God. Let God have God's way.
Hallelujah.
Oh, that's a word for the preacher this morning. If I let go and let God have God's way.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Our aftermath series has been a series that is teaching us what happens during Easter leading up to Pentecost. And next Sunday is Pentecost. Can y'all believe it's Pentecost already? We've had 50 days of Easter, and we have walked with Jesus and the disciples each and every step of the way. Pentecost this year falls on Memorial Day weekend, but we live stream, so I know that you're going to be worshiping on Pentecost. Amen? And if you're in the city, Pentecost is such a big deal that I hope you will make your way to the sanctuary. It's the birthday of the church, the celebration of the gift of the Holy Spirit in our lives. But before we get there, we celebrate the ascension of Jesus Christ. And today we will go to the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter. And we're going to read today verses 44 through 53. I'm reading from the New Living Translation this morning, and I want to invite you to stand with me as we read the Gospel of Jesus Christ. Then Jesus said, "When I was with you before, I told you that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and in the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said, "Yes, it was written long ago that the Messiah would suffer and die and rise from the dead on the third day. It was also written that this message would be proclaimed in the authority of his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. There is forgiveness of sins for all who repent. You are witnesses of all these things. And now I will send the Holy Spirit, just as my Father promised. But stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven." Then Jesus led them to Bethany, and lifting his hands to heaven, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up to heaven. So they worshiped him and then returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they spent all of their time in the temple, praising God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, here we are to worship. Here we are to bow down. Here we are to say that you are indeed our worthy and our holy God. So have your way, Holy Spirit. Have your way, Holy Ghost. Pour out a fresh anointing on us. For we have come expecting a word from you. Hide this, your servant, behind that old rugged cross, so that everything that is said and everything that is done comes straight from you, O God. This is your servant's prayer. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So we begin today, if we back up just a little bit, to verse 35 in the 24th chapter of Luke, we understand that the folks have been on the road to and now from Emmaus, shouting the good news that nobody stole the body of Jesus, but that Jesus is indeed risen from the dead. I don't know about you, but if I didn't know this story and somebody came running down a road at me and they started screaming, Jesus is alive. And I know what I saw with my own eyes. I know that I saw them take him down off that cross. I know I saw that lifeless body fold up. I know I saw the blood come out of his hands and out of his feet, and all of a sudden, somebody is running at me, screaming that this Jesus is indeed alive. I don't know about you, but that sounds a little crazy to me. And I know I'm not always 100% sane, but this sounds even more crazy than usual. But the people of God should not be surprised. Through the prophet Moses, and through all of the prophets that have come, we have heard that there will be a Messiah. We've heard that there will be a Savior. We've heard that Jesus will die and will rise to life and will be ascended into heaven. And that this Messiah will give us an advocate, the Holy Spirit, who will walk with us every step of the way. But yet we're still surprised when Jesus shows up. We're still surprised when Jesus shows up and says, hey, y'all. Wait, you weren't expecting me? What have you been doing? I told you that they would come and get me. I told you that I would be betrayed. I told you that they would beat me. I told you that I would die on the cross. I told you that they would put me in a tomb. I told you that I would rise from the dead after 3 days. I told you that there is more to do. But we can't be so hard on the disciples because we're the same. We're surprised when Jesus shows up. We're surprised when we're at the last lap and at the finish line and we think we're not going to make it over. And then the Holy Spirit comes and pushes us over and we say, oh, we made it. We're surprised that God is keeping God's promises unto us. We're surprised at the power of God to continue to work in our lives. But why? We've been convinced that in this life, what we can see is the only thing that's happening. We've been convinced that in this life, what we can understand, what we can translate, what we see with our very eyes, our own limitations are the only things that can happen in this life. We even have a bad habit of telling other people that what they have experienced is not real and not true. Just because we haven't seen it. just because we haven't experienced it. Just because it's not ours, we try to tell other people that what has happened in their life is not real. Verse 35 says, when the two from Emmaus told their story of how Jesus had appeared to them as they were walking along the road, and how they recognized him as he was breaking bread, Jesus himself was suddenly standing there. Hello, dead Jesus, what are you doing here? We were just talking about you. We were just talking about how you abandoned us, how you didn't care about us anymore, and how we don't know what to do now because you left us. And Jesus said, peace be with you. And still they're scared. They are afraid and they are frightened as if they were seeing a ghost. Jesus said to them, why are you frightened? Why are your hearts filled with doubt? Look. Look at my hands. Look at my feet. Touch me and make sure that I am not a ghost. It's really me. Ghosts don't have bodies. And they stood there in disbelief. And then Jesus said something peculiar. Do you have anything to eat? Do you get the promises of God? Do you remember the promises of God? I will be with you always. You can trust me always. I will feed you until you want no more, always. I am walking with you and talking with you, always. You don't have to be afraid, always. I am always working on your behalf, always. I am God all by myself, always. I don't need you to try to be God, always. I've got this, always. I'm the one who hung the moon in the sky and the stars in the sky. You think I can't do a little bit of work in your life? Always. I promised you a savior. Always. It may not look like what you want it to look like. But I'm doing it always. It's been a tough week in the United Methodist world. United Methodist churches all over the globe are deciding that they don't want to be United Methodist anymore. And those of us who are born and bred United Methodist, we're having a hard time with it. We don't understand why people can't just see things the way we want them to see things. Why they can't do it the way we want them to do it. And why we have to have a great schism because we can't seem to agree on one little thing. That's not the real thing, by the way. But it's the thing that we've made popular. Yesterday in South Georgia, I think the number was 193 churches decided that they didn't want to be United Methodist anymore. And I started my week in Texas with what they called the anchor pastors. And in that room of anchor pastors who have been working on the unity of the church for at least the last 10 years, it hit me. I'm angry. I didn't know I was angry. But it hit me like a lightning bolt when some of my other colleagues said, you know, I could just quit. All this work, and what has it been for? Or I could just strangle them. How come they're tearing up my church? And the anchor just rose up and rose up and rose up and rose up. And then somebody said, yeah, you know, one day I got so mad I went on Indeed and I started looking for another job. And the Lord used Indeed to remind me that this is not my church. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to God. They're not my people, they're God's people. This denomination has nothing in terms of time on the church of Christ, the church universal. And since the beginning of time, people have disagreed about what they believe about Jesus. And guess what? It's been okay. In this life, there are going to be some things that knock you for a loop. In this life, there are going to be some things that make you scratch your head and say, Lord, why? In this life, there are going to be some things that stop you dead in your tracks and make you wonder if God is still keeping God's promises. And every single time you get to that crossroad, you will need to stand up and remember that God said that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. That in this life there will be trouble and I will always be with you. That things will not go your way and God is at work. Give me something to eat. And he ate as they watched. You ever heard the phrase, I hear my help coming? I feel my strength coming. I feel like pressing my way. This is that moment for Jesus. All his friends have abandoned him. The people who are supposed to know what comes next are acting like they have no clue what's going on. The people who are supposed to have faith are full of doubt. The people who are supposed to march on and teach others about the resurrection and about abundant life are in a ball in a corner somewhere. And they watch the resurrected Jesus eat. Can you imagine? I imagine that Jesus walks into that room and he takes on all of those fears and those doubts and it knocks him for a loop. I imagine maybe it's like a church council meeting when people, the pastor has some great idea or some person has a great idea, a vision of what could be, and everybody else is stuck in what used to be. I bet it felt like the Back to Egypt committee, where everybody wants to go back to their comfort zone instead of where God is calling us. And there was nothing else left to do but eat. So Jesus ate, gained his strength, felt his help coming, and said, "Let me reset this for you. Let me remind you of who you are. Let me remind you of whose you are. Let me remind you of all those promises that have been coming to fruition in your life. Oh, and by the way, let me show you my power." In verse 44, "Like I told you before," it actually says, "when I was here with you before," but "like I told you before, everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and in the Psalms must be fulfilled." That's why we have to go to Bible study, y'all. That's why we have to read our Bibles. Because sometimes we miss out on the promises of God because we don't know what they are. We don't realize that there's nothing new under the sun, but if you read the Old Testament very closely, it's already there. "Everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And he said, "Remember, long ago, it was written that the Messiah would suffer and die and rise from the dead on the third day. And it was written that this message would be proclaimed in the authority of his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem." Here's the message. There is forgiveness of all sins for all who repent. You mean to tell me that this Jesus, the walking dead, has come to life and is now telling me that the people who threw rocks at me, the people who shouted, "Crucify him," the people that have been hunting me down, the naysayers, the wrongdoers, those who smile in your face and stab you in the back, those of little faith, those who live in doubt, those who are always just on your nerves. If I do my job, tell of the good news of Jesus, then they get an opportunity to repent, they get forgiveness of their sins, and they get to live abundant life with me and with Jesus? You mean there's no us and them in God's economy? You mean there's life and life and life abundantly in God's economy? You mean that I get to experience this promise of abundant life right here and right now, and I don't have to wait until I'm dead and resurrected with Jesus? then there's more. I will send you the Holy Spirit, just as the Father promised. But stay together until the Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven. The reason I talk so much about our behavior is because it matters. The power of life and death is indeed in our tongues. When we speak doubt, we sow doubt. When we speak about what's not gonna work and what's not gonna last, we put it out there in the atmosphere and it's powerful. When we complain instead of rejoice, it literally shifts the atmosphere away from abundant life and into doubt and difficulty. Your mindset matters. Your speech matters. Your thoughts matter. How you show up matters, because you have the gift of the Holy Spirit, which means that you have power. Promise. God always keeps God's promises. Power. You have power from heaven, so stop abdicating it and giving it away and acting like you're a powerless victim. Praise. Jesus led them to Bethany. You remember Bethany? It was right outside the city. It was a place of worship. He led them from their place of fear and doubt in Jerusalem. He led them from the place of their victimization. And he led them to Bethany, a place of praise, a place of water, a place of power. He led them from despair and doubt and difficulty and disappointment and led them to a place of worship and abundant life. And there, y'all don't hear me this morning. Maybe I put it this way. When I was growing up, they used to sing a song that said, I moved from my old house. And I moved from my old friends. And I moved from my old way of life. Thank God I moved out to a brand new life. Thank God I'm not standing in the same place. Thank God I'm not saying the same things. Thank God I'm not hanging out with the same hateful people. Thank God I'm not singing the same old dead song. Thank God I've moved. You can't stay in the old place and expect something different. You can't stay in the same mindset and expect something different. You can't keep on singing, woe is me, and expect something different. You gotta get up and move. Jesus led them from Jerusalem to Bethany. And lifting his hands to heaven, he blessed them. You see, at the end of the day, It was never about Jesus, for Jesus. At the end of the day, it had always been about God's people. At the end of the day, it had always been about abundant life for you. At the end of the day, Jesus came and lived and died and suffered and was resurrected so that you and I might have life and have it in abundance. Mary, that's why I get so upset when everybody's like, and we got this problem and we got that problem and we got this and we're not going to do this. We're not going to move. We're going to go. The rapper said, y'all gonna make me lose my mind up in here. Because after all that Jesus been through, he moved them through promise to power and into praise. He lifted his hands to heaven. He blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. So they worshiped him. And then they returned to the old place to tell everybody else to get unstuck. Gosh, I don't have enough time for this, to unpack this today. They worshiped him. They returned to Jerusalem filled with great joy. Changed. Remember, they left Jerusalem full of doubt. They went to a place of worship. Got changed, transformation at the place of worship. And then they went back to the old place of doubt to help those people experience the transformation. So many times we leave the old place and we look back and look down on the folks in the old place instead of going back and reaching for them and pulling them into a place of transformation. You know those people in your life that you met Jesus, but when you hang out with them, you go backwards. Ouch. You had a hallelujah good time in church. The Lord spoke to you. The Lord released you from some things, and you go back and let them put it back on you. Instead of helping them to be released in the name of Jesus. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Ascension. They didn't have a funeral. They didn't sing any dirges. They worshiped the Lord. And they spent all their time praising God. You know what's really hard? To complain while you're praising God. You know what's really hard? To be mean while you're praising God. You know what's really hard? To live in doubt while you're praising God. You know what's really hard? To be mad at somebody while you're praising God. You know what's really hard? To live in a, I don't know how that's going to work. I don't see what she's going to do. I don't believe that. I don't see that. All the naysaying is really hard if you are praising God. Promise. I told you a long time ago, and now it has happened. Power. You have power from on high. Live like it. Praise. If you spend your time in praise. May your struggle keep you near the cross. May your troubles show that you need God. May your battles in glory they show. Worship is always the antidote.
Yeah.
Praise will always set you free.
Yeah.
If you believe in the promises of God, then you must believe in the power of the Holy Spirit in and through you. And if you believe of the power of the Holy Spirit in and through you, then you must spend your time in praise. There's no other way to live. And that, my friends, is what gets us to Pentecost. This praise, this promise, this power, this praise, it gets us to Pentecost, which ushers us to the front door of abundant life. Go in peace, knowing that you know that you know that you know that God is good, that God keeps God's promises, that you have the power of the Holy Ghost in and through you and in your life, and that if you'll just spend your time in praise, you'll know that you know that you know that God is good. Bless you. Bless you all.